This video is brought to you by Law Excellence IAS Academy.
Dear students, good morning. Welcome to DEEP, Daily Editorial Enrichment Program. Let us start discussion on today's newspaper, that is 4th May 2019. The first article, a image makeover of Belt and Road Initiative. So in Belt and Road Initiative, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, Bangladesh-China-India-Myanmar Corridor, and then Maritime Corridors, like this many are there. So in this context, a good prelims question can be, what are the various legs of Belt and Road Initiative? So this Belt and Road Initiative has many controversies to it. The major issues are, one, developing countries where this initiative is taken up. The China is not giving the preferences to the countries per se, and it is deciding the projects which need to be taken forward. It means that China is determining the developmental priorities of those countries. And these project costs are exorbitantly high. It means the interest rates which the countries are supposed to pay are going to make these countries into a debt trap. The simple example is Hambantota port in Sri Lanka. So now what the China is saying, it is going to take extensive consultations, understand the developmental priorities, and more, sees every project as a collaboration rather than imposition. And the second, as the priorities are determined by the China itself, the Chinese companies are given the preferences. The material is procured from China, and the next, the project is executed by China. In that way, the Chinese companies are becoming profitable. So instead of this, it has to be open up for international bidding and also foreign investments, and foreign companies shall participate in that. So China has agreed that it is going to allow foreign investments and foreign companies in this entire process. And hidden geopolitical agenda is another complaint. India, United States of America, all these are worried about hidden geopolitical agenda. China is trying to dominate economic and political landscape of the world through Belt and Road Initiative. In the context of India, string of pearls, that is developing various ports surrounding the India's coast, is considered as part of the geopolitical agenda. So added to that, India have a special concern, that is sovereignty concern. So Gilgit-Baltistan is, as per the accession, it has to be part of India. But due to the situation existing at the time of independence, it got into Pakistan. So the present China-Pakistan economic corridor moves through the Gilgit-Baltistan, so which India is opposed to on sovereign claims or sovereignty claims. So in image makeover of the Belt and Road Initiative, China has clearly stated that there will be extensive consultation with the partners to determine the developmental priorities, and a joint contribution between China and other countries. The benefits will be shared. In this process, foreign investments, foreign companies will be allowed for. So this is what the Belt and Road Forum's latest updates are. A new fault line in post-war Sri Lanka. This is about recent Easter bombings in Sri Lanka. So after the terrorist attack, the Sri Lanka's fault lines across the communities are increasing. So when we have a collective national identity, and if we submerge all other identities in this collective national identity, then the unity of the country can be better preserved. Unlike this in Sri Lanka, we have regional identities. Added to that, communal identities, ethnic identities are getting deepened. We have Sinhalas, and then Tamilians, and Muslims. So these are the three prominent communities. Sinhalas are majority, and they are mostly the Buddhists. Tamilians are a minority, but these are dominant in north and east provinces, Jaffna, Batticola, in these regions, and they are mostly Hindus, and few of them are Christians, and then we have Muslims. Now, in Jaffna, Batticola, especially Batticola region, the Muslims are a significant percentage, up to 30% of the population. So when we have this kind of population pattern, and ethnic divides develop across the people, and ensuring communal peace becomes very difficult. So over a period of time, the prejudices between the people are increasing, and lack of understanding of each other's way of living is making the things much worse. And radicalization of youth, especially the majority, is undermining or making the minority insecure. So the Sinhalas, they are more and more, the attacks on the Tamilians and also on the Muslims are increasing. So here, there is also a fight between Tamilians and Muslims. So the minority factions do not trust each other. So the majoritarian violence is affecting the minorities holistically. And among the minorities, there is a mistrust between the Tamilians and the Muslims. So this radicalization of the Muslims after their exposure to the West Asia, it is making the other minorities insecure. So especially, so recently, there is change in the appearance and more becoming conservative kind of way of living. It is clearly visible as part of the radicalization. And finally, opportunity loss. It means more and more traders' roles across the Muslims, and it is seen as a loss of opportunities for the other minorities, and relative wealth which has been distributed unequally across the communities, these all making or widening the fault lines. The essence is this. The first is prejudices, more conservative way of thinking, and radicalization after exposure to West Asia, and majoritarian violence, opportunity loss from one because of one group to the other group. This all is creating more mistrust between the groups. And now, the violence, especially terror violence, added to this. So in this context, the way forward is de-radicalization and building the interfaith trust and making the people to come together. And the third is the government shall ensure that the national RLs, the wider agenda or wider identities, which is Sri Lankan identity, prevails over narrow identities over there. Essence of democracy. So this is about ongoing elections and criminalization of politics. So why can't be criminals banned in elections? The Representation of People's Act bans those who are convicted, not who are accused. Obviously, if accused are been banned, that can be misused by the political parties. It means they can claim a false case and then they can get him banned from the elections. In that way, the entire process can be misused. That is the reason why what the Supreme Court stated, it is not the accused, it is only the convicted who has to be banned from the elections or who has to be disqualified. So in this context, the legal system is very slow in India, and it runs on a dictum that innocent until proven guilty, which was given by Sir William Garrow. So innocent until proven guilty. So it means the burden of proof lies on the state. And this burden of proof, if a minuscule of doubt, it has to be, or it has to keep the accused free. Using this as a provision, many of the people are able to contest the elections. So that is the essence of the article. So how to decrease, how to fight this criminalization of the politics, it is a very big challenge before the government today. Now, GST buoyancy. You know, in April month, the GST collections have reached its peaks. It was like never before. It is 1,13,865 crore rupees. Then what can be the reasons for this? The first is, the number of people who are paying the tax have increased. It means increase in tax base can be a reason. And the next is, arrears are being cleared. Normally, whatever the arrears that have accumulated, the business people try to clear at the end of the financial year. So the end of the March, it has led the people to clear all the existing arrears and close their account books. And the next, GST Council has reduced the tax rates on various products. So it incentivized the people to pay the taxes and helped for the widening of the tax base. And finally, tax authorities, there might be a strong force of strong enforcement. But I am doubtful about this strong enforcement. The reason is, in the election season, the government is not very willing to enforce these tax laws. I mean, enforce or threaten the traders. So in this, especially the election season, I am doubtful about this strong enforcement, sense of enforcement. But irrespective of all these things, what we need is simplification of the GST regime. As the government is no need to worry about the collection, fiscal deficit now, it has to focus on the simplification of entire GST regime. And the next, Spanish steps. So in Spanish, in Spain, Mr. Sanchez, Pedro Sanchez, he has won the election. He is a center-leftist. So in the Europe, the winds are changing. So in France, Hungary, the rightist elements, conservative rightist elements have dominated. But slowly, centrist and leftist elements are taking the central stage. So this is a good sign. So more than this, we don't need to remember anything. If I look at the Spain, Catalonia issue is one thing I will majorly focus upon. So there was a referendum which was held, which was not accepted by the Pedro Sanchez and secessionist parties. They want to make sure that Mr. Sanchez will not come to power again. So the Catalonia issue is the most important over here, rather than who is coming into power. There are two points to remember. The winds are changing in Europe. The rightist conservative elements who have come to power at the height of immigration crisis are being replaced by leftist and centrist forces now. And the next point we need to remember is the Catalonia and the issue of referendum. And finally, thank you very much. Have a good day. All the best.